delighted to have Edel here tonight. Edel Russell is Innovation, Consumer and IT Director of Musgrave Retail Partners. I'll just give you a quick brief there on Edel. Having joined Musgrave as part of the graduate programme in 1994, Edel worked in the trading and marketing departments of various categories, which include marketing and consumer insight roles. In that time, Edel delivered SuperValu brand innovations such as SuperValu Real Rewards loyalty programme and SuperValu online shopping. Earlier this year, Edel was appointed to the board of Musgrave Retail Partners as Innovation, Consumer and IT Director. In this position, Edel is responsible for delivering best-in-class consumer insight to drive further innovation in SuperValu and Centra. The title of Edel's presentation is Putting Insight and the Customer at the Heart of Your Business. And I'd like to welcome Edel there to the podium. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Feel slightly bigged up after that presentation, so hopefully I live up to your expectations. I'm delighted to get an opportunity to speak to you all this evening and to share with you what we do in Musgrave to keep the consumer at the heart of our business. I'm going to start by telling you just a tiny bit about myself. You've heard some of it there. And I've been with Musgrave what feels like forever as my life speeds past me. And I did join in 1994 on the graduate programme. At that stage, they used to take kids straight from primary school, so I'd like to make sure you know that. On the first year of the graduate programme, actually, was when I joined. So I came straight from UCC, having done my BCom. And my only motivation for joining Musgrave was the fact that I knew that I liked to shop. And I figured if I liked to shop, I could buy. So I went straight for buying, and that was what I wanted to do, to get into trading and to really start to get into a job like the trading section in Musgrave was fantastic on the graduate programme. And it was in trading that I spent the first 10 years of my time in Musgrave. I went through various buying roles and then eventually became a category manager. So I bought everything from toilet rolls to sausage rolls. And I did, I suppose, a number of different categories, which gave me really good experience. And I worked with some fantastic suppliers during that time. After that, I was made head of innovation. And what we really did there was to create a dedicated team of people to take a few projects and to move them from good ideas to actual delivery in store. The two big ones that we did was the Real Rewards program, or loyalty program, that now has more than 800,000 members, and our SuperValu shopping, online shopping business, which we rolled out our 48th store this morning, and now 75% of the Irish population can shop online with SuperValu. So there are two areas that I suppose I would have had a lot of experience in. I then took on the remit of consumer insight and I moved over to the marketing department. And this was really around the time when Musgrave was starting to invest a lot more in insight. It was obvious that the level of change that consumers were going through as the recession started to kick in meant that we had to be closer than ever to what their needs were. We needed to make sure that all the way through our planning that we were asking the right questions of the right people. And more importantly, we really needed to gear up the business then to deliver on that insight and deliver faster and better than anybody else would do in the market. As we just said earlier on, in April I joined the Board of Management, and in my remit I still head up insight, and I've taken on the full agenda of innovation for the business, and then in my spare time I run the IT function. So what I would like to do tonight is really focus in on the insight part of our journey and what we've been doing to put that consumer that's ever-changing into the heart of our business. So what I was going to do was just to take you through four chapters tonight, tell you a little bit about Musgrave, tell you how we use and gather insight within our business, share some of the learnings on the journey that we've been through, and hopefully they're just my perspectives. They're things that as I took stock, I realised that the journey that we'd been on. And then I'm just going to have a go at sharing my view and our view as to some of the trends that are coming our way. And no matter what business you're in, I think they will affect everybody in the market as we see it. So starting with Musgrave, it's a very old company. It was started in 1876. By Stuart and Thomas Musgrave, two brothers who married two sisters, and it's still very much a family-owned business. Over 75% family shareholding, and all the rest held by Musgrave staff through a share ownership scheme. there was a lot of key milestones in the history of Musgrave and very much a part of Cork, I suppose, as Cork grew up as well. Things like the development of the Super Value and the Central brands, the purchase of our business in Northern Ireland, in Spain, in the UK, and most recently our purchase of Superquin. So Musgrave is a partner to entrepreneurial food retailers and food service professionals. We still very much see ourselves as a family business, and we're a family business that supports other family businesses. We work with entrepreneurial food retailers to give them and their consumers the food that they need, and also give them products, marketing, IT, support, logistics, everything that they need to run a vibrant local business and employ people in the local community. We want to bring people, or we want to have stores there that people can visit. We're not trying to just bring people to stores. We really want to serve the communities that we operate in. Musgrave is a very large company, and our retail sales in 2011 were over 7 billion. We work with over 3,500 stores across four areas. So we're in Northern Ireland, in the Republic of Ireland, in Great Britain, and we're in Spain. And between ourselves and our retail partners, Musgrave employs 55,000 people. In Ireland alone, we employ between ourselves and our retailers 35,000 people. So that makes us the second biggest, just after the government, in terms of employment. So we're important to this economy and we're very committed to this economy. Our business involves both retail and wholesaling elements to our business. You can see from the map there where we operate. We have six divisions. We have Retail Partners Ireland, where I work, which supports Super Value and Centra. We have Musgrave Wholesale Partners, which supports our cash and carry business, you know, the cash and carry up on Airport Road, and also serves Daybreak retailers. We have a Northern Ireland business in Super Value, Centra and Mace are supported out of Northern Ireland. And in Great Britain, we have two retail brands, one called Budgeons, you'd see them the odd time if you ever visit London. And we also operate the Landis brand in the UK. And in Spain, we have two retail brands as well. Our newest division is called Musgrave Operating Partners Ireland, and it supports the Superquin business. And the purchase of Superquin gives a very strong presence in Ireland, or in Dublin, an area that Supervalue wouldn't have been particularly strong in, and it brings our share overall to 22% of the market. And given its fresh food leadership, its commitment to suppliers, its real, I suppose, focus on quality fresh food, it was a great match. And it was fantastic for Musgrave to be able to continue to invest and support businesses within Ireland. The entire Musgrave business is built on partnership, which at the heart of it, that partnership is Musgrave values. And they've been with us since the very beginning. They're long-term stable relationships, not being greedy, honesty, working hard, and achievement. And as I said, they've been there and they've formed the absolute platform of all of our decisions as we work through a tight economy. I work in the division Musgrave Retail Partners, and we have two brands, Super Value and Centra. I'm sure you all know both of those brands. Super Value, there's 195 in Ireland, and it's a very strong supermarket brand, committed to quality, committed to locally sourcing where possible, working and employing as many people in the local economy as possible. And we have very strong, I suppose, focus on making sure that we give back within those communities. In Centra, there's 460 across the country. We really feel like we're at the heart of every community. Different kind of formats of Centra, so you'll see neighbourhood stores, like a store you'll see in Rochestown, or a city centre store just down the road from us in Oliver Plunkett Street. And obviously we have forecourts as well. So we have a number of different types of Centra that operate within the market. 75% of the goods that we sell are either produced or manufactured in Ireland, and we continue to be committed to that. And I already spoke about the number of people that we employ, the 35,000, which is actually more than Google, Microsoft and Intel all added up together. We provide a very diverse range of employment as well. So as well as the entrepreneurs that set up their own stores and the excellent careers that that gives people in retail management, 38% of those working in Supervalue are under 25, 11% are over 50, and 62% of them are women. So last year we had a wage bill of 632 million. So we're very important in terms of employment and payment from a consumer point of view and a market point of view. We're big in the Irish market, and I think sometimes you mightn't hear from us or see us waving as many flags as other retailers do. So I think it's important that we share the fact with every audience that we get to meet. I have two very short videos which just show you some of the numbers that are behind the both of the brands. So we'll start to give you an indication of that. Sense of the size of Super Value and Centre. As I said, sometimes we're probably a bit low key, but you can see very important in terms of purchasing power, in terms of the number of people who interact with our brand on a daily basis. And that's probably why it's so important that the insight function is on top of that. So every day, 300,000 consumers visit a Super Value store, and nearly 500,000 visit a Centre store. So our job is to keep them coming back and to make sure, and the only way we can do that is to keep them happy, giving them what they want every time that they're in with us. So to do that, we need to understand what matters to them and what will make them shop with us. In the last 12 months, we've talked to nearly 12,000 customers, and everyone from mums who work at home to school-going kids, to college students, to retired people. We talked to a huge range of different types of customers. We talk to people who are loyal to us, who shop at us all of the time, to see, make sure that we're doing what it takes to keep their business. We talk to the people who have left us, who don't shop with us anymore, to understand why they don't. And we talk to people who shop with our competitors more than they do us, so that we understand what we need to do to get their custom. Every week of the year, we're listening to customers. We're on the pulse, and we really feel we have to be, given the rate of change that's there now. The average Irish person goes to a shop to buy groceries nearly 5 times a week. They have more choice than ever before, there are more retail stores than ever before, and they have a major challenge in their income every week. They feel that they can control their grocery spending more than they can control a lot of their other bills. So if you think like of something like telephone bills or electricity, that's a lot harder swap to make. Changing a retail store and shopping somewhere else is as simple as driving in a different direction or not putting something into your trolley. So they're very much in control and they know that. So for us to keep them coming back, we need to keep gathering insight. I thought it'd be worthwhile just sharing, so it's my view on what insight is, and it's one of these things, if you Google it, there's about 50 million different perspectives on what it is. And it's probably a great exam question as it stands. I think sometimes that it's easier to talk about what insight isn't rather than what it is. So for me, it certainly isn't just facts and figures. It's not data about market share or penetration or sales numbers or numbers of customers buying a particular product. That's an input, but it's not an insight. Neither is it an opinion. So it's not about a gut feeling or something you heard in the grapevine or something, and now all of a sudden it's an insight or a bit of observation. And most importantly, it's not easy to get to. Getting to the true insight is really hard work. It requires looking and listening to lots of inputs and pulling out the real meaning out of those. So to me, insight is a lot more fascinating than data and numbers and things on a page. It's really understanding how a consumer thinks and what motivates them, what matters to them, and how they're feeling. So getting to the nub of what someone is motivated by, that's a real insight. It's about how they feel about themselves, how your product or your service makes them feel, how your brand makes them feel, and underneath it all, so stripped way back. So it's not an observation of what they're doing. It's more about their values and their beliefs. It's not about what they're doing, it's about why they're doing it. And as I said, that's what makes insight hard to really get. So it requires stripping back all of the different layers of data, the quotes and the focus groups, and really getting to a couple of simple statements that depict the true insight. It's about asking why until you get to a place that everyone can go, aha, now I understand why that is happening. What's challenging in all of us and all of this is that people are really complicated and customers are really complicated. If only customers could be simple, we'd all have an easy life. So what they're saying isn't always a true reflection of what they're really feeling. So sometimes they're managing the message that they want to look like they feel a certain way, or they think that's what everybody else is saying, so I better say the same thing. And Irish people aren't always the most open and vocal about how they feel, well, the men anyway, and that makes it all a little bit difficult for us. And the other thing that makes this really difficult is what people say they are doing and what they're actually doing can be two different things. So all of this makes a real insight a bit of a challenge, but let me show you how we work through it and the sources that we use and how we capture all of the different insights to help us to really come to that nub of the issue. Really, the essence of our journey starts with us building the right sources of insight, and then we work with those to keep asking those questions of why until we get to that motivation for the customer. So we're not trying to dive in to solve what is happening, but rather try and understand it and solve why it's happening. So to help us to understand their motivations, we use a combination of qualitative research and quantitative research. We don't have a large insight team in Tramore Road, just a couple of people, but we work with insight partners who know our brands and they know our business and have been working with us for some time. And they do the legwork on our behalf. For our quantitative research, we partner with a few companies who help us to get the necessary quantitative insight. We use Red Sea. You'd often hear them talked about for political polls. They do some work for us. Kantar and Nielsen. Kantar use a panel of customers to read market shares and track shopper behaviour over time. You'll often see them quoted on the market shares in the newspapers every month. They issue a report to the press. So they use a large panel of customers that are supposed to be representative of the population and all locations. And they scan in their grocery shopping every week and where they bought it and what time they bought it. So all of that is gathered in massive amounts of data, and then reports are generated from that. And we use that to help us to understand how we're performing in the market and what is happening with how the customer is shopping. So for example, one of the big changes that we've seen over the last 12 months is a surge in what we're calling little and often shopping. So customers have less cash, they're managing their budget day to day, not week to week, and they're very much visiting stores, more stores, to get better value and to avoid any kind of waste. They can't afford to be throwing anything out. So little chunks of little shopping here and here, there and everywhere is what we're seeing, and Kantar would pick that up. It would see more frequency of shopping happening within the market. Then we work with Red Sea, and Red Sea helps us to track our brand perception. So they're a great research partner. As I said, you've heard of them before doing political polls. And for us, they talk to about 1,000 members of the public every month, and they dig into their views on where they do their grocery shopping and why. We do that face to face. We are starting to do a little bit more of it online now, but we ask them things like, where do you do your shopping for your big trolley shop? What store would you recommend to somebody if you're looking for a store that has great value or has good quality or cares for the local community or has a great loyalty card? So we go through loads of different criteria with those customers. We also check that they've seen and heard our ads and that they know it was us that was talking. And then we check, did they do anything different because they saw that ad? So they help us to track that our brand perception is improving. So what people think of Supervalue or people think of Centra is moving in the direction that we wanted to. We track that over time. So if we get, we call it a bad Red Sea report in any given month, we don't flip around the place. We know that it's about looking at the trend. Are we improving in the areas we said we wanted to? What is the mood like, and how are people feeling about our competitors as well? So with all the people, we also talk to people that we know shop with us. And this is really important because this is a gauge of what our own customers think of the experience. So for people with us, again, what are they feeling? What are they thinking? What do they think about our range or quality or promotions or loyalty card? Asking all of our own customers those kind of questions. And they rate us, and then we can compare how other competitors rate themselves as well. So what's, I suppose that whole view gives us a real temperature check for Supervalue and Centra, gives us a sense of how we're performing in the context of how everybody else's customers are performing with them. So the things that makes a super or customer drive from one store to another, we really feel like we're on top of the big criteria that makes them motivates them to do that. So as I said, it's all about tracking that over time, seeing the direction that you're going, and on the areas that we said we wanted to get better, are we actually getting better? It also helps us to identify things that might be emerging, so things that might be coming an issue, starting to emerge in it, and then we can dig deeper. And that's where our qualitative research comes in. It really helps us to pinpoint the why that is happening within our performance. So we do a variety of different kinds of qualitative research. We tend to use focus groups, we use accompany chaps, and we do in-depth interviews often in people's homes to really help us to dig in. The good thing about focus groups is that you can really probe with the customers and understand and talk directly to the people that you know you need to understand. So for example, if Red Seas tells you, you seem to be having a problem here connecting with moms with small children, you can do groups of moms with small children and understand what are the issues, what are the reasons behind that lack of connection. So it really gives you that why behind it. We do focus groups really regularly, and we use this as well as a great way to tap into the mood of Ireland. So what are people thinking and feeling and doing? What's their outlook like? And then we can start to think through what will that mean for how they shop and do their grocery shopping and who they do it with. So we really use it as a gauge of what the mood is like within the market. As well as focus groups, we have gotten a lot from home studies where we've sat in people's homes like lunatics and gone through their cupboards with them and asked them all these questions. Why did you buy that? And where did you buy that? And why is that sitting there and looks like everything else is used? So really get very good, interesting insight. And people are much more open in their own home. You're on their territory. And they'll tell you a lot more of their reasoning behind it. Let me give you an example. We were looking at our own cereals range, so breakfast cereals. Mightn't be exciting for everyone, but it's exciting for us as a big category. And we, again, did that in-store or in-home visit, and we took photographs of what we saw. And what was flabbergasting was the numbers of boxes of cereal that every home that we went to had, was 6 or 7 or 8, and how customers talked about how expensive cereals are and how they will move from one retailer to another if the price of cereals is right. So again, that wasn't a category that you would have said, oh, it would really be a motivator for customers. But if you've got 2 teenage kids who eat cereal 3 times a day, it is very motivating. So those kind of insights you don't get from a quantitative piece of research. You get it by sitting down and talking to people and understanding why and how they're using the product. We also do accompany chaps. We follow people around a store. Now, we do ask for their permission, so we're not like stalking anybody. It's a very funny experience, actually. It takes people a while to warm up. They're extremely healthy at the start of the shop, and by the end of it, they're bored of you, so they're putting in the wine and the chocolate biscuits. So it's certainly, I suppose, a very good insight into what cuts through with people in a store. And what's really funny is if it's actually very depressing if you work in marketing and you've got these beautiful point of sale and it's all up and looking fabulous, and they walk right past it, they didn't know, you draw their attention to it and they still aren't interested. It's all about the shelf, and it's all about the shelf that they're interested in. Very difficult to interrupt customers or get them to draw attention to something that they're not on that autopilot shopping route to buy. So I'd encourage you to do it. As I said, it's really interesting and very easy to do. So combining the quantitative brand health check with the focus groups and the shopping with the customers and sitting in their homes, we really can uncover some meaningful insights, and we can start to validate what we see in quantitative research with what we hear in qualitative research. We really get those two pieces working as well as we can together. The insights team job then is to really distill all of that down into some simple statements that the business can work with. It's not about telling everybody how the business is performing or what's happening from a numbers point of view. That's the job of the accountants. Our job is to tell people why this is happening and help them understand what's needed. And it's not an easy job. Anybody in insight will tell you, you spend a lot of your time with a lot of reports open and trying to figure out, what is all of this telling me? What is the one thing that I need to take from all of these inputs that I have? And all I can say is, like anybody else working in insight, keep asking why until you just can't ask it anymore and you've really got to the nub of the issue. So once we've got the relevant insight, the next big thing we have to do is engage the rest of the business and what we need to get on with. So firstly, share that insight in a way that's compelling and telling that story, and then make sure that it's actioned within the business. So the right people are doing the right things so that we deliver on that. We have a forum in our business called the Consumer Forum. It's around for a very long time. It's evolved over the years. I chair it, so it's much better. But we have a mix of key members of our various cross-functional teams working there. So we have our salespeople in there, we have our trading people in there, we have our marketing people, and we all get together and we go through the insight and we agree what we need to be doing from an offer perspective for consumers so that it'll be really meaningful and it'll make a difference. We plan ahead. So right now we're thinking about, believe it or not, our plan after Easter next year. So that's what we have to do in retail. You have to think way ahead. You have to predict what will people be feeling like, what will be thinking, what will they be doing. And that's what you're always trying to do, is predict forward. What happened last Easter? What was the big trends that we saw? And how is that going to map out next year? So we have to keep going on and asking those questions and make sure that we're creating the right plan. So we work, as I said, with both the quantitative and qualitative insights. And from an investment point of view, we invest in the right people, but more importantly, probably the research partners who are experts in this help us to ask the right questions of the right people. And we use all of those inputs to create a real insight of what matters to our customers and what will make them shop with us in the long term. I thought I might share just two quick case studies with you just to show you insight into action. So where we took insight and where we made an action as a result of this. I'm going to start with Centra. As you can imagine, in the middle of a recession, when people are really watching what they spend, it can be very difficult to keep relevant if you're a convenience store. So people are going to assume you're a lot more expensive. It's a bit of a luxury to shop there. I can't afford it. I need to shop in the big supermarkets. So our big risk was that we would become irrelevant to people as times got really tough. And the price was becoming really important. And we knew that. So we could have gone off and started to make major changes in certain areas, but we did a lot of research. And what we uncovered in that was that despite how tough things were and how bleak the outlook and how depressed people were, they still wanted to experience little lifts during the day. So even though indulgence is out of the question and they couldn't afford it, people still wanted to kind of have some sense of brightness in their day. And things like little things like that were starting to mean an awful lot more than they would have done in the past. And from this insight was born a real new brand focus for Centra. We wanted to brighten up your day. And we looked for new ways that we could do that. So this wasn't just about a tagline and saying that. We did things like we upped the spec of our coffee. We launched new treats like muffins that were really great value for money. We created a whole new restaurant range of meal called Table for Two, so people could have restaurant quality for €6 for two people. So we really went after those areas to help consumers to have little lifts to brighten up their day at a time when things were tough. So life could still be enjoyable, it could still be a little bit brighter, and Centra could help you to do that. We also worked with our retailers and said that we can say things like brighten up your day and then a member of the public come in and you'd be grumpy. So we've said your staff need to be cheery and helpful and really look after those customers. You need to brighten up their day with a smile. And that was something that really was engaged our retailers as well. So you can see us there. We did products, we did some marketing, we did a few different things, built in the insight that people needed to have their day brightened up. And it is working. Centra is by far the leading brand in convenience in the market, going well ahead of nearly all the supermarket players, let alone other convenience retailers. Let me give you another example. If I talk about Super Value for a moment, about 2 years ago, we could see the impact that the recession was starting to have on customers and how they were changing, how they were spending. And the limited range discounters, Aldi and Lidl, were obviously opening up a lot of new stores and were probably becoming more acceptable as a place to go shopping. And we knew that, in particular, mums on a tight budget were really struggling to manage their shopping bill every week and to cope with that austerity budget that was taking more and more and more from them all of the time. So we got a cross-functional group together and we gathered a lot of inputs. We had sales and marketing and trading there and our buying teams. And we shared all of the data that we have, and we really wanted to step into the shoes of that kind of customer. So we shared a day in the life of a mum, a young mum with young kids, from the lunchbox craziness in the morning, to the collection, the school run, to the after school activities, to the evening time, you know, chatting with our friends on Facebook. So we really gave people an immersion in what a day in the life was. And then we gave them some homework. They had to go and interview some moms. They had to go onto websites that moms use. They had to read the magazines and the newspapers and listen to the radio that moms did. And to be fair, some of the men were never the same again, and they've got in touch with their feminine side. But absolutely, it was that live in their shoes was absolutely powerful. And when we got everybody back together again and did our workshop, We asked people to pull out the big surprises of what you saw. One or two people were talking about, I can't believe the amount of time that they spent chatting on the internet. We didn't want them to know that necessarily, but those kind of insights, people were really surprised at how people's lives were changing. And they got some fantastic, deep insights as to what we could do to help them. And there were some things that became more and more obvious, that it wasn't all about the price of things and austerity and negativity. The number one thing that was important to Simone was her family, making sure that she gave them the right quality, healthy food, had her kids were happy and healthy. That was her number one thing, and that was the thing she needed help with. Quality was a big concern for her, making sure that whatever she produced in the home tasted great, that everybody ate it, there was no waste, you know, that she was doing everything that she needed to do. There was probably a little bit of baggage there from the old Yellow Pack days, and people weren't sure about what kind of products to buy in terms of own brands. There was a bit of negativity there as well. There was a real desire to buy Irish-made food from local ingredients, but not to pay more for it. And value was essential. So whatever we did had to help mums to spend less on their shopping every week, without settling for poor quality or foreign brands. And they also needed a bit of inspiration. They were absolutely fed up of cooking and churning out the same batch of meals all of the time, just because that's what everybody ate. They were bored. And they really needed to feel like they were adding a little bit of inspiration and enjoyment to the family meal. And it became obvious that the solution to all of this had to be Super Value own brand. And we built our own brand strategy based on all of that insight. So we sourced all of our products with care. We wanted to buy as much Irish as we could, and most importantly, deliver the absolute best quality that we could. So we tested every single product independently. We improved every product that needed to be improved so that it was as good as, if not better than, the brand. We wanted to inspire our customers to cook, so we connected with people like Kevin Dundon, a celebrity chef, very popular with the moms, and bring a bit of magic and inspiration to mealtime. Nothing fussy, nothing fancy, just using the ingredients that they're familiar with, but putting that extra twist on it to make it inspiring. And finally, to help our customers, we made sure that they saved at least a third in their shopping bill if they switched to own brand. So we really felt that this was a compelling proposition to consumers, but we needed to interrupt their thinking. We needed them to realise that things had changed, that the old Yellow Pack days of quality were gone, that there was, you know, much more, I suppose, quality to be had now in the Super Value range. All of this led to our Say Hello campaign for Super Value own brand, which is the biggest launch that we've ever done. I hope you're aware of it. And a couple of weeks ago, we won a major advertising award for this campaign. And I think it shows that we did really try to tap into the insight and deliver kind of a whole new concept to consumers. As I said, we had to interrupt their thinking about own brand, and we had to show them that our people were committed to giving them good quality and that we stood over it. And we followed this after with a supplier advert, which shows our customers the care that we go to source that product for them on their behalf, so that they can get a fantastic Irish-produced product. You might indulge me and I'll play the ads for you, because I think I've given you more of an insider story now, and you might see some of that coming through as I show you the ads.
At Super Value, we've been working on something really big. Over 1,500 products.
All quality checked.
We believe they're as good as, or even better than, the leading brands.
What costs? They're on a third less.
Say hello to the new Super Value range.
And take our taste challenge
and see how you can spend around the third less in your shopping with the new Super Value range.
I'm Tom Downs, and our farmer owned co-op makes the ice cream for the new Super Value range.
There's 120 of us working here, but today us four are off to Super Value. Let's see how our ice cream does in a taste test against the best selling brand.
We represent 2,000 dairy farmers, and our relationship with Super Value is important to every one of them.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Please taste the two products and just leave your spoon beside the product you prefer.
Taste tested against the leading brands and around a third less. Say hello to the new Super Value range.
So I think that shows you a campaign in real life that was really based on consumer insight and things that we needed to do. The only problem I have with it is I can't be on a night out and hear that song and not think of work. And everybody in the place says that it comes up a lot on Twitter, how we've ruined that song for people, which is terrible. So I suppose what I've been trying to do is just share the journey and how we gather insight and give you a sense of our sources. And we've been on that journey for a couple of years. And as I prepared for tonight, I just thought there was a few ideas that came to my mind. It started off as two or three, but there's probably a few of them, but I'll rattle through them on the things that I've learned and we've learned as a company as we've tried to improve and put the consumer really at the heart of our business. I've said it a couple of times, but the role to me of the inside people and not beyond the inside people is to keep asking why. So to get to that real motivation behind what is happening, why is that happening? Don't settle for things, generic statements that don't mean anything, that don't have any impact. Keep asking, and that's the job, to make sure that we understand the why behind everything. I say listen to all consumers, and what I mean by that is sometimes we talk about the consumer, and I've probably done it a lot myself tonight, as if it's something out there, as if it's some, you know, group of beings. We're all consumers. We all have families. We all talk to people all of the time. And I really encourage that you don't dismiss that kind of feedback. Hearing what people are saying on the ground, you can hear an awful lot of things that are totally relevant to your business and your brand. And keep listening and make sure that if something is starting to come up in a few places, it's worth digging in for more. So again, that thing of listening to all consumers, everybody that you're connected with. Create the forum in your business where that insight is actioned. There is no point having the most amazing, clear insights and then the business goes, well, we're going to do what we're going to do anyway. Your job is to keep jumping up and down until the insight is understood, appreciated, and then that the plan is there and put in place so that everybody's on the hook, really, to get the insight and to action it. I'm a believer, really, in that you believe what you discover yourself. It's a lot more powerful to have uncovered insight through that time with the reports or all the inputs than somebody standing in front of you and telling you, here's the insight that you need to know. Doesn't suit every business, doesn't work all of the time. But I go back to that workshop that we ran about the moms. People still talk about it. They still refer back to what they discovered through that journey. So helping people outside of the insight team to do some of that digging with you is really important. And it could be as simple as getting people to sit in the back of the room for a focus group that normally wouldn't. All of that is a learning, and it gets you, I suppose, a new kind of insight that you wouldn't normally have. Get the balance right. Don't ignore the research. But don't knee-jerk react to it either. It's trying to get the balance right of saying, oh my God, is this something I really need to act on now? Is there something big and deep here? Or is it something that we'll wait and see, we'll give it another month or two, we'll do a bit more research, we'll keep digging. So making sure that you get the balance right between reacting and understanding, deeply understanding that this is something or a trend that is here to stay. And that probably takes a lot of time and maturity of your team as well to understand that. I think it's also important to tell it as a story. So again, you know, bullet points like I have up on the screen are a lot less compelling than telling people things that you have heard or people have said to you. I'll give you an example. We were out in focus groups just last month, and one of the groups we talked about, you know, how people were feeling, what they were feeling about the budget and Christmas coming up. And when the report came back, it said, mood very subdued, consumers increasingly concerned. It was a grand. And then the guy who was presenting back to us said, I was in a group where a mom was talking about that she's always threatening her kids that if you're bold, I'm not taking you to the toy store on Saturday, and that she spends most of her week worried that they won't be bold because she'll have to take them and she can't afford it. So those kind of things are a lot more, I suppose, compelling than statements on a screen. So the quotes and the stories that come out of the groups and come out of the insight, so tell it as a story rather than big statements up on a screen. Be as focused on your strengths of your product, your brand, or your service as you are about the weaknesses. And I think it's probably the usual Irish tradition of we focus on the things that are wrong and what we should do to fix them. But you can very quickly ignore areas where you're seen in your customers' eyes as better than anybody else. The number one thing to do is make them even better again, create that real distance between you and your competitors, and spend as much time understanding the why behind your strengths as we would the problems and the why that's happening. It's really important to understand and protect those strengths. Work with professionals, make sure, I suppose, that you, to me, it's worth its weight in gold. Yes, insight is and research is expensive, but spend as much as you can afford. It is well worth it. You never look back and say, well, we didn't get anything from that. I would suggest then that you haven't dug enough into it, or haven't really pushed your partner as hard as you could. So help them to understand and get the real insight behind that you need to progress as a business, and give your partner everything that they need to know. So give them the context of why they're doing this research, not just a research brief. They need to understand what's going on in your business so that they can help you to really dig into the issues that you're having. And also keep your research partner involved in the solution. They have the insider track. They can help you to see that what your plan is really does deliver in the insight that they help. So keep them involved. I think anybody in research, Colette included here, would tell you that it's very hard sometimes when you've handed in the research to know what happened after that. I wonder what they did. And all insight partners would love to hear, you know, could you come back in? We've got a solution. We'd love to know your ideas on it. So keep them involved. I'm sure that they want to be involved, and how it has driven action in your business. And find a way to create that dialogue, a two-way dialogue with your consumers, and where it's obvious that you're listening to them and responding to them, and make it two-way. We did a Facebook chat recently with a nutritionist and celiacs. So we just said, we're going to have a nutritionist here talk about celiac disease tomorrow at 12 o'clock. There was a massive reaction to it. And the suggestions that we got were fantastic. So there were, can you have celiac pizza, please? Can you have loads of ideas back from these customers? The worst thing we could do is just file that away. Now, it's really important that you, if you're having that two-way dialogue, that you're seen as responding. So posting back up on Facebook 2 weeks later, we've got a celiac pizza. It's going to be in every store from next week. So those things, it's really important that you're seen as listening and responding. They want to know that what you've done, that you've listened to them. Tread carefully on this. I mean, obviously, online research is growing. There's no question of that. Research through social media is probably an area that's a bit more challenging, and make sure that you can properly mediate it. That can be a bit of a challenge, and keeping the conversation balanced. People sometimes make a career of going in and interrupting those conversations with all sorts of terrible things. So sometimes it can be difficult, and then it's there forever. So just, I suppose, tread with caution on that kind of thing. And stick to the insight until you can see that it's delivered upon. It's the easiest thing to do is to say, well, I landed the clear insight and nobody did anything about it. That's not really good enough. You need to leave it, I suppose, work really hard with your marketing departments and your trading departments to get through to the right action. And if you believe in it, I suppose, stick with it and shape the solution, be part of that solution and validate it. So that's probably our journey and our learning so far. What I was going to do just to, before I finish, was just to give you, as is my perspective and our perspective, on some of the big consumer trends for the future. These aren't plucked out of the sky. We did a big piece of strategy work lately, which really brought our brands up to 2016. And these were some of the inputs. We worked with the likes of Amoruk and Red Sea again, a number of different research partners to help us to kind of envisage what was going to happen within the market, the retail market. And I really think that these trends, as I said, if you're not in retailing, they still are going to be relevant to any area. The number one trend that we all know and we all are putting up with, I suppose, is that relentless focus on value. It'll be no shock to you that consumers are really focused on getting value for money in their grocery shopping. What might surprise you is the degree to which it really is affecting their outlook on everything, on their whole life. Customers have probably about 100 to 150 euro less to spend a week than they did before the austerity budgets. That's assuming they kept their job, and as we know, that's not the case for everybody. So things have got an awful lot tighter. So every bill, every activity, every single expense that customers have, they're going to scrutinise it, and they're really going to ask themselves, do I need it, and do I need it right now? And this has meant that customers have made massive changes to their lives, and about 80% of households say they've majorly cut their spending. And this new consumer is on a mission, and it's a mission to get as much as they can for as little as possible. And they're willing to invest the time to get that, so they're doing their homework. So when we talk to customers, they talk about sitting down on a Monday morning with everybody's handbill and circling the different deals that they're going to go to the different retailers to buy. So they will go and they will make 4 or 5 trips to get the best possible offers. So they're willing to give it the time and the effort involved in doing it. Another trend under this is about avoiding waste and making food go further. And one of the big things is that consumers can no longer tolerate food waste. I know my parents would never have tolerated in the first place, but I certainly didn't think much about throwing the old bag of lettuce into the bin. But people are hyper about it now. It was worked out lately that the average household throws away 1,000 euros worth of food every year. And I know it's no surprise when you think about it, it really adds up. Consumers cannot afford to do that anymore. So it's not a passing fad, it's changing how people are eating and cooking at home. So they're cooking in bigger batches, they're using their freezers, they're freezing their sliced up lemon for their gin and tonic on a Friday night. They're doing everything. The freezer is the new fashion, I think, in people's homes. So everything is getting used up and nothing is getting thrown out. So that's trend one, the consumer that's obsessed with getting value and willing to do the homework and save the money in order to do that. The second one is omni-channel. I know that sounds like a really scary word, and I've a lady who works for me who's called the omni-channel manager, and she said, my mother's disgusted with me, how can I tell the ladies in Bridge that you're doing that job? Sure, none of us know what it is. Omni-channel really reflects the fact that technology has moved on massively for consumers. And that they have to hand the information that they want instantly. So the smartphone or the tablet computer that so much of the population carry around now has more technology in it than it took to fly the first man to the moon. And over 3 out of every 4 people will have a smartphone by the end of this year, and half of the Irish population will own a tablet. And we can also envision a time really soon where consumers are paying for things with their mobile phone. It's only months away. And already 2 in 3 smartphone users said they'd be quite comfortable to do that. 1/4 of all of the websites are now viewed from people's mobile phones. And this isn't just about young people, it's about all generations. Everybody's starting to engage and use technology an awful lot more to control and edit their lives. So they can shop now while they're queuing in the morning traffic, and they can check opinions on a hotel before they book. So it's really about putting the consumer back in control. And for us in retailing, it means our stores are never closed. We're always open, we're always on. So what omnichannel means is that the customer has lots of different ways to connect with your brand now, and that you need to create one customer view of how that connection is and make sure that it's a consistent and a positive experience. So if you look at SuperValue, everywhere from our online shopping business, to the emails we send, to the letters with vouchers that we send to people, to our texting, to how you experience our customer service in the store, all of those different touch points have to be one positive, seamless, personalised experience. And that really is the future. It's also creating an era of big data, another one to Google because there's lots of articles on this too, but this sense of all of those touch points now creates a piece of information about that customer. Piece of information that might help me to deliver better on their needs. So companies now are going to become flooded with all of the different kinds of data, and customers are going to become more and more protective of their information and how you're using that. Customers don't mind you using their information once they've given you the permission and once it becomes more relevant to them, so that you're tailoring the offer that you give. And very much, I suppose, an omni-channel future lies ahead, and I think it's important that all brands react to that. Another trend is health and well-being. I suppose, really, despite the recession and despite all the pressures to cut bills, customers are going to continue to care about their health. And their health is their wealth now, so they're really in tune with staying well. I think you all know the surge in people who are taking up running or cycling or triathlons. It's really going back to basics. It's more that DIY health. People know there isn't a quick fix there. We see movement towards health also, not just being about physical health. That it's also going to be about managing emotional health, about mental health, that all of these topics are going to become more of a talking point for consumers. And all of this is affecting what they buy and what they're eating. And we believe that we're going to see a lot more return to scratch cooking over time. Think about it as well, in the household structures that are there, you're now going to see a lot more grannies and grandsons in the same house, so 3 generations in one house, where cooking skills might start to be passed on again. So those kind of changes are happening, and they're going to change what people are eating and cooking at home. And of course, obesity is still a major issue for consumers. And for us, we're focused on offering choice. Helping people to find health, not being preachy about it, just helping them to uncover the kind of health that they need that suits their lifestyle. And bear in mind, as I said, that there's a baby boom going on. We've a boom at the other end as well, which obviously that older people are living longer, staying well for longer, and their big concern is staying as healthy and able-bodied and independent as they can for as long as possible. So as I said, that kind of multi-generational family is going to change how people are active within their communities and also active themselves within their families. And the final area that we see really, I suppose, emerging is a sense of belonging and a sense of community. So as Ireland has been through a tough couple of years, and we probably have heads hanging in many cases, we're starting to see an emergence of the importance of being Irish, of looking after each other, of knowing what's important, and I suppose the whole sense of community starting to become more important again. And this is going to be a really big part of Ireland's recovery, not just from a fiscal point of view, but from an emotional point of view as a country, how we get through this as large communities of people who want to get out of this as soon as we can. And it's knocked a lot out of us, and I suppose what we see happening is that consumers are really starting to connect to their local communities, and communities are no longer just about where you live. They can also be about connecting with people that you have things in common with. And we believe that the sense of belonging to some of those communities is going to really come out and become more, I suppose, relevant to people in how they live their lives. And we think that as a brand, we need to be the people who helps connect some of these communities. So online communities like the members of EU Moms, all the new moms in the country, or people like celiacs that I talked about earlier. So being part of that conversation and helping those customers to get to meet their needs is a big part of what our brands are about. Customers want to feel that they're doing right by these communities and that they belong and that they're going to make Ireland a better place to live. And this really isn't about waving the Irish flag or putting stickers on products or putting posters in windows. What is important to consumers is that this is real, that it has substance. It's about actions and it's about rolling up sleeves and digging in and helping within the community. And this really has value in the eyes of the consumer. Our retailers know this and they're hugely committed to their local communities and they're investing and employing locally to enrich the lives of their local community and to create a new sense of pride of place. That really builds a great place to be. And we think that this matters more and more to people now and that it will continue to grow in importance as Ireland tries to get through this and come out the other end, a better, stronger country. So I've shared with you who we are, how we gather insight, how we action that insight and some of the learnings that we've had along the way on that journey. I think insight is an absolutely fascinating area and I really think we have the best job in the company. We put the customer at the heart of our business. We are the best friend that whispers in the ear of the MD to tell him what he really needs to know. Don't mind the accountants. I'm going to tell you what's really important. We have the power to make our brands better and our products better and grow the business of our company. Now, no one said that's going to be an easy job. And I know that you know it isn't an easy job, but I love it. Thank you for listening.